You're watching City Channel 4, your window to our community.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. I start in the name of Allah, the most merciful, the giver of mercy. And Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, this is actually the first verse that came in the Quran. In the name of Allah, the most merciful, the giver of mercy. So we see in this first verse that Islam started out with mercy. And as we will see at the end, that Islam also ended with mercy. And I greet everyone in this room with the greetings of Islam. And that is peace be upon all of you. That is the greeting that we were taught by the Prophet Muhammad. May peace and blessings be upon him and upon every single messenger. The topic that we are going to talk about today is Islam against terrorism. And this is an extremely important topic. Islam against terrorism. Because today, as we see, all of us, of course, we see in the media, in CNN, Fox News, MSNBC, and so on, we see a group of people who have a banner that they claim that this is the banner of Islam. And they do some actions that they claim that these actions are from Islam. So we are here to say that these actions are not from Islam. And as we will see from the sayings of the top scholars of Islam that are alive today and the previous scholars, condemning all of these actions. So Islam against terrorism. What is Islam and what is terrorism? Islam, the Islamic faith, and the word Islam, it means to submit to the will of Allah. And Allah is the Arabic term of the word God. That is Islam. And this Islamic faith, it has six pillars. The first pillar, as you will see, is to believe in Allah. That He is the one who have created the heavens and the earth. And He is the one who created everything that you see. And He is the sustainer and the maintainer and the provider. And that He is the only one that the son of Adam or the human beings should worship. The second pillar of Islam, and that is to believe in the angels. Allah, that Allah have also sent angels. God have sent angels, angel Gabriel and Mikael and so on and so on, sent angels to this earth. And He sent them with books, like the Quran and the Torah, and many people do not know about this, but we believe in Islam that Allah has sent books from before. He sent the Torah to the Prophet Moses. And He sent the Injil to the Prophet Jesus Christ. May peace and blessings be upon him. And He sent books to the Prophet Abraham and many prophets from before. In Islam, we believe in all of those books. And we believe in all of those messengers. And we don't separate between messengers and others. We don't say we believe in Muhammad, peace be upon him, and we disbelieve in Jesus, peace be upon him. Or we don't say we believe in Moses and we disbelieve in Muhammad and Jesus, peace be upon all of them. We believe in every single prophet, and we love every single prophet, and we believe all of the books that came to them, and we love all of the books that came to them. And we believe the God that they call to. Whether you call him in English Allah, or you call him in Arabic, or whether you call him in English God, or you call him in Arabic Allah. And also we believe that there will be a day of judgment. All of us will be resurrected. And everyone will be asked, Muslims and non-Muslims. They will be asked about the good that they have done. And they will be asked about the evil that they have done. Non-Muslims are not free from this, and also Muslims are not free from this. So just because someone says, I am a Muslim, this does not mean necessarily that, okay, he will go to heaven and the Day of Judgment. But he will be asked, did you actually act like how a Muslim is supposed to act? And also we believe in destiny, that everything is planned by God, everything is planned by Allah, and everyone at the end will return to Allah. This is Islam in general. And as for terrorism, as you see, the Merriam-Webster dictionary says, it's the use of violence against acts to frighten the people in an area as a way of trying to achieve a political goal. And the thing that we should notice here, in this definition, Islam is not there. So we see the definition of terrorism does not include Islam. And it does not include Christianity, nor Judaism, nor Buddhism, nor does terrorism, the definition of terrorism, include any religion. Because all of the religions, they all condemn terrorism. Islam condemns terrorism. Christianity condemns terrorism. Judaism condemns terrorism. And the killing of innocent people in Islam or any other religion or in humanity, all of that is forbidden. And all of that is hated by Allah and is hated by the people. And also, if you go to the FBI website, and this is getting this, I got this from the website of the FBI, they defined terrorism, international terrorism and domestic terrorism, and also Islam is not included in it. Why do I say this? Today in the media, whenever you see a violent action done by an individual or a group of people, this is called, they call it sometimes massacre, they call it terrorism. But when do they call it terrorism? When someone who is a Muslim does it. If someone follows the faith of Islam and he does an evil action, kills an innocent people or innocent group of people, whether it was in the name of God or not, this is called terrorism. And if someone goes and kills children at a school, then this is not called terrorism. And this is something that is unjust. Terrorism is terrorism, whether it is done in the name of religion or if it's not done in the name of religion. Killing innocent people for any reason is incorrect and it's unjust and is condemned by Islam. And here I give you an example of the Mufti of Saudi Arabia. And this is taken from Al Jazeera English. He said that extremists and militant ideas and terrorism which spray decay on the earth, destroying human civilization, are not in any way part of Islam, but are enemy number one of Islam, and the Muslims and their first victims. This is the Mufti, the spiritual leader of Saudi Arabia. So lots of time people say Saudi Arabia, they are the ones who are, for example, all the terrorists are coming from them, and all of the terrorists are coming from the Muslim countries. The spiritual leader of those countries is saying that the number one enemy of Islam, he didn't say the United States, nor France, nor Europe, or Russia, or any of those countries. He said those extremists who kill people in the name of Islam. They are, he said, they are the number one enemy of Islam. Like ISIS and Al-Qaeda and Jabhat al-Nusra and Hezbollah and Boko Haram, all of those are extreme and all of those are number one enemy of Islam. And then when he was asked about September 11th, the day which lots of Americans died unjustly, he condemns it. And he said that these actions are not from Islam, and that the Sharia of Islam, and the word Sharia, it means law. Basically, the Sharia, all it means is the Quran and the sayings of the prophets. When someone says Sharia, it means Islam in general. Said the Sharia law is against this 100%, and it condemns it, and it does not approve of it. This was a few days after September 11th. And likewise, after the terrorist attacks in Paris, when they happened, also the scholars of Islam, they came out and they said that these actions are against Islam, and Islam does not support it. And someone might say, okay, this is something that they say. And the terrorism, they don't do terrorism against Muslims. So these terrorists, they focus on killing non-Muslims. A scholar by the name of Ibn Uthaymeen, he was asked this question, and he died in the year 2000, before the event of September 11th. So he was asked, how should Muslims live in a country that is controlled by non-Muslims, or that in a Christian country, or a Jewish country, or any country that is non-Islamic? He said that people should live in this country. How? He said, I invite you to have respect for those people who have the right that they should be respected, those between whom there is an agreement of protection for you. For the land in which you are living is such that there is an agreement between you and them. If this were not the case, they would have you killed or have you expelled. So preserve this agreement and do not prove treacherous through it, since treachery is a sign of hypocrisy and it's not from the way of the believers. So it's not from the way of a believer. For someone who is a Muslim, and then they migrate to a Muslim country, to the U.S., for whatever reason, it's not from the way of Islam for them to do terrorist actions. Why? Because any immigrants, any people who come to the United States or any non-Muslim countries, to enter into that country, they have to sign a paper. And by signing this paper, they are making this signature saying that we will not harm anyone, and we will abide by the laws of the land. So this great scholar of Islam, he said, when Muslims go to non-Muslim countries, then they are not allowed to hurt anyone, and they are not allowed to commit any of these terrorist acts. And the reason why the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, said, whoever kills one who is under an agreement of protection will not smell the fragrance of paradise. And this is talking to the Muslims. So any Muslim who kills a non-Muslim for any reason, the Prophet said that that Muslim, in the Day of Judgment, he will not only not enter the paradise, but he will not even smell the paradise. That is because killing an innocent person, whether he was Muslim or not, this is something that it's illegal in Islam. And he then said, do not be fooled by those sayings of foolish people, that those who say those people are non-Muslims, so their wealth is lawful for us, they are mistaken. By Allah, this is a lie about Allah's religion and a lie about Islamic societies. He's talking about the extremists who have this idea that if you go to a non-Muslim country, you could steal the wealth. You could take a loan and not pay it back. And you could do whatever you want. These extremists like Al-Qaeda and those followers of Osama bin Laden and Hezbollah and ISIS and all of those extremists, they have this view that your wealth is lawful for them to take however they want to take it. But the vast majority of the Muslims disbelieve in that. And all of the scholars of Islam say that this is something that is unjust and this is completely against Islam. So, and then he goes on to say, O Muslims, be truthful when you're living in a non-Muslim country. Be truthful in your buying and in your selling and renting and leasing and in all mutual transactions. Because the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, tells us that we need to be honest. And what does the Quran say about terrorism? Allah says in the Quran in chapter number 4, verse number 29 and 30, or you who have believed, do not consume one another's wealth unjustly, but only in lawful business by mutual consent. And do not kill yourself or kill one another. Indeed, Allah is to you ever merciful. And whoever does that in aggression and injustice, then we will drive him into a fire, and that is for Allah will be easy. So it doesn't matter what religion you follow. It doesn't matter under what banner you are. Killing civilians, killing innocent people, in Islam, even if you are Muslim, this is something that Allah hates. And what does God tell us in the Quran? He said, Allah does not forbid you from dealing with non-Muslims who don't kill you, and they don't harm you, and they don't kick you out of the land. But Allah wants you to be good to them and say nice things to them. That is a verse that is mentioned in the Quran. And also Allah mentions in the Quran and say good things to the people. And if we see the life of the Prophet Muhammad from beginning to end, his whole life and his treatment to other people was a treatment of mercy. And one day while the Prophet was sitting down, there was a funeral that was passing by. And this funeral was a funeral of a Jewish man. It was a funeral of a Jewish man. So while this funeral was passing, the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, stood up for the funeral. So the man who was next to him, he said to him, O Prophet of Allah, the person, this funeral is a funeral of a Jewish man. Why are you standing up for a Jewish man? So the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, said, he is a human being. So he stood up for him. Or when one of his neighbors would take his trash and put it in front of the house of the Prophet Muhammad, and he was a Jewish man, there was Jewish people in the area where the Prophet were. He was a Jewish man. Every single morning, the Prophet would wake up and he would see the trash of that person in front of his house. One day he woke up and he did not see any trash. So he went to his house and he said to him, I didn't see the trash, are you okay? Is there anything wrong? So this is the mercy of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. And you would see his mercy towards the animals. The Prophet tells us of a story of someone who went to paradise. For what reason? He was thirsty. And there was a dog who was thirsty. So instead of drinking water first, he gave water to the dog to drink. Then the Prophet Muhammad said, peace be upon him. And because of that action that he did, Allah made him enter into paradise. Not for water for a human being, but he gave water to a dog. In the United States, people here love dogs. But usually in our countries, we don't pay much attention to them. But in this culture, in our culture, people don't usually pay attention to dogs. Yet the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, said that this man entered into paradise because he was merciful to dogs. And he told us the key of entering into the paradise of Allah. So he said, I will say it in Arabic, مَنْ لَا يَرْحَمْ لَا يُرْحَمْ. He said, whoever does not show mercy to the people, he will not see mercy on the Day of Judgment. And he told the people to be merciful to your family and merciful to your neighbors. And I end with this quick story. In one of the battles, and this is the battle, it's called the Battle of Uhud. And it was a battle between Muslims and non-Muslims, and both of them were Arabs. At one moment of the battle, the non-Muslims had the upper hand on the Muslims. And the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, was injured. So he was scared for the non-Muslims after they injured him. And he said, how can a group of people be protected in the day of judgment after they heard the Prophet? So Allah sent revelation to him, saying, it is not up to you, O Muhammad. Allah might forgive them, or Allah might punish them because they are wrongdoers. Now these are people who are fighting against him. And these are people who are trying to hurt him and hurt the Muslims. And the Prophet got scared for them. And then he raised his hand to make this prayer for them. And he said, oh God, please forgive them, they do not know. He said, oh God, please forgive them, they do not know. They hurt him. And he said, oh God, forgive them, they don't know better. This is our beloved Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. And if you listen to this and you read his biography, you will see that what ISIS is doing, or what Al-Qaeda is doing, or Boko Haram, or any terrorist group that are doing of killing innocent people, that this is not from Islam. All of this is not from Islam. So this is in conclusion, Islam condemns any terrorist actions done by any people. In the Quran and in the sayings of the Prophet, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, and whoever kills one person unjustly, then he has killed all of the mankind. This is a verse that Allah has given to Moses in the Torah. And it is a great verse. And what the Quran says about the Torah, Allah says in the Quran, we have sent the Torah, to Musa. In it is light and guidance to the mankind. And then he repeated that verse in the Quran. And he said, whoever kills one person, then it's as if he has killed all of humanity. And whoever saves one life, then it's as if he has saved all of humanity. And I end with this, and I ask Allah to protect all of us from any evil, and to guide all of us to that path which he loves, and to spread peace in this land and in the entire world. And I will take questions if there is any. If anyone has a question, there is a microphone that you can come. Brother Shakir, if you can bring the microphone to him, to the brother.
Thank you very much for coming here today to talk to us. And I appreciate your sharing what Islam is based upon. But there are thousands of people in the world who proclaim themselves to be Muslims, yet do not live by these beliefs. In fact, they're organized in ways that are counter to these beliefs. Who are these people?
Okay, that is a very good question. The Muslims that are, the population of Muslims is about 2 billion. So there are about 2 billion Muslims that are living today. Out of those who are extremists, they, if we give them like the largest number that we can give them, say 100,000 out of 2 billion. Who are they? There is a prophet, the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, said a saying that there will come a time, there will be a group of people who are Muslims. They will be young. They will read the Quran, but they will not have any understanding of the Quran. They will kill the Muslims before they kill the non-Muslims. He said, if I find them, then I will fight them. And then he said, whoever is killed by them, then glad tidings be to him or to her. And whoever fights them, then there is a great reward in it. And these are the people of ISIS and Al-Qaeda and them. Where does that ideology come from? This ideology comes from ignorance, from misunderstanding of Islam. These groups of people, they would take verses out of context. For example, they would take the ayat of jihad. Jihad, by the way, is part of Islam. Jihad is part of Islam. In the media, we see jihad as ISIS, and this is not jihad. Jihad is part of Islam, and the meaning of jihad is to strive. To strive for what for whatever sake. For example, if someone is teaching people the word of God, that is jihad. If an enemy attacks a country and that country is defending itself, that is called jihad. What the Prophet ﷺ, peace be upon him, said that whenever a group of people go to jihad, he said, do not kill women, do not kill children, do not kill old men, do not kill people who are not fighting, do not cut down trees, do not kill unjustly, and be merciful. So these people, they take parts of the Quran and they use it unjustly. For example, I will give you a great example. In the Quran, a verse says, part of a verse says, kill them wherever you find them, or fight them wherever you find them. That is part of a verse in the Quran. So they would leave the verse before it, and they would leave the verse that comes after it. The verse before it says what? Because they were the people, the companions of the Prophet Muhammad, were forbidden from fighting. And then at one point, they were given permission to fight. So that's why the verses came down. And it said, now you are allowed to fight back and protect yourself. But do it in the sake of God. And it has to be those who are fighting you. Do not fight anyone else. And do not fight or kill anyone that is not fighting you. And then the verse after it said, fight them wherever you find them in the battlefield. The verse after it, if they stop, then stop and make peace. Do not fight. Even though they have started the fighting, but the Quran said, if they stop, stop. Because Islam wants there to be peace. So they would take these verses out of context. And sometimes they would see injustice happening in the Muslim world. For example, a group of people will be killed unjustly, right? Or there will be a war, for example, the war that happened between the United States and Iraq, right? And this war, most of Americans, according to my small knowledge, disapprove of it. This war, lots of innocent people died. And it doesn't mean that either side is bad, but lots of innocent people died. And when the media shows the images of dead people and dead children, the people feel sad. And they want to rebel and they want revenge for the things that happened to them. So out of ignorance, they would join groups like ISIS and like Al-Qaeda, and they would go and terrorize innocent people that had absolutely nothing to do with this battle. So this is kind of where it comes from. I don't know if I answered the question.
Yes, you did. Thank you. And if I may follow up to that, I appreciate that reassurance. But in view of that reassurance, why does Islam not stand up against, I guess these people would be infidels to Islam? Mm-hmm. Why is there no outcry? Why is there no resistance, or at least that we are aware of?
There is, but it's not shown. It is, but it's not shown in the media. For example, Al-Qaeda, first of all, it started in Saudi Arabia. And the regime in Saudi Arabia were extremely tough on them, to the point that they could not survive in Saudi Arabia, so they all moved to Yemen. And in Yemen, there's a weak government. Actually, at that time, half of Yemen was not under control of any government. And today, there is absolutely no government in Yemen. So they go to places where there is no government, and they spread their terrorism from there. There was no terrorist attacks that started out from Iraq. At the time of Saddam, there was not Al-Qaeda or ISIS or any of those groups. Once Saddam was taken down, and once there was no government in Iraq and no one to fight against them, after that, ISIS took Iraq as a stronghold. And they could not go to Syria until Syria became a chaos and there was no one to control Syria. Then ISIS moved on, and Al-Qaeda, they moved on to Syria. So they always go to places where there is no governments. But if you go to any Muslim countries where there is a government that is controlling the area, then you will not see any terrorist groups and you will not see any extremists. I believe this gentleman had a question.
Thank you.
Let's check it. Okay. No, he could sit this, if you could pass the microphone next time.
Do you know how many Muslims are currently serving with the U.S. military, and do Muslims encourage other Muslims to join the U.S. military?
Okay. I have no knowledge of how many Muslims are serving in the United States military, but I know there is a big number of Muslims serving in the United States military. Do Muslims encourage, and does Islam encourage to join the U.S. military? We don't encourage joining any military that is not in a Muslim country. Why is that? Because in Islam, when we fight, it has to be for the sake of God. Right? It cannot be for the sake of revenge. It cannot be for the sake of anything other than for the sake of God, meaning it has to be merciful and there has to be certain rules in it, right? So we don't encourage that. Does it encourage fighting alongside of the United States, to fight terrorists alongside of the United States? Yes. And as we see, as the countries who are fighting ISIS or Al-Qaeda, a lot of them are Muslim countries, whether it's Saudi Arabia or Qatar or Egypt or Jordan. They are all fighting alongside of the United States. So to join an army, it has to be in a Muslim country for the Muslims. But if Muslims, they join the United States Army as American citizens, there is a number of Muslims who do that. And they're all considered Muslims. Except in Islam, we don't advise that. We advise strictly to be a Muslim government. Yeah. But there is no harm in it, of joining it. Okay. So. After her, you can give it to the brother.
Hello. Could you please speak a little bit about how stereotypes related to Muslims in the Iowa City community being related somehow to terrorists has impacted or affected the community in this area of Muslims?
Islamophobia is something great in this country. And most of the Muslims here can tell you about it. Even me and my wife, sometimes when we go to the library, not this library, but a different library, all eyes are on us, usually. And this is due to ignorance and the media, like, spreading Islamophobia day after day after day, right? And there are people who are nice and like all of you, and they come and talk to us and they ask us, why do you dress like this, why? Because usually I go, I dress in this garment, right? So stereotypes is something that is great. And Muslims suffer a lot from it, right? But usually we get lots of help from the FBI and from the police department. We get lots of help from them. And usually if there is any problem, the FBI would call me and they would tell me that some groups might try to do this today, right? So it's there, and the best way to fight against it is to do things like this, to tell the people that we are not terrorists, and Islam is not about terrorism, and we're just like you. Everyone who is a Muslim in this room came to this country or born in this country. They want to live simple lives, just like regular lives, just like you are living regular lives. They want to go to school. They want to get a job. They want to have a family, and they want to see their children do great things, like all of us do. So this is what every Muslim here wants to do in this country. And it's a great country, and there are lots of Muslims. I go back home, and there are lots of Muslims back home who wish they can come in this country and have the opportunity that we all have in this country. So the best way to fight stereotyping against Muslims is to talk about it and to spread what Islam is. And once, I'm sure once people know what Islam is and that Islam is against terrorism, all of this would die down. And just like the evil things that were happening to the African-American community, from slavery and so on, all of these things do not change until people start talking about it. That the African-Americans, they are not second-class citizens. They are people like all of us. Or the any other groups of people, or the LGBT community, they're all people that are like all of us. And the Muslims, we are like all of you. And the Buddhists and the atheists and everyone, all of us are human beings at the end. And there is a great verse in the Quran, and it's a beautiful verse. He said, "O people, we have created you into different tribes and different races. For what reason? So that you will get to know one another." So this is a beautiful verse that Allah tells us in the Quran why we are different. We are not different to hate each other, but we are different to get to know one another, to know different cultures, to know how to experience different things. And all of that is from the beauty of Allah's creation. Allah created male and female, short and tall. They created different things. And at the same time, all of those different things, they can come together and they can be one people, even though they are different. And there is nothing wrong with being different. Yes. And this brother over there.
Thank you for speaking with us. My question is kind of pertaining to Europe and the fact that a lot of Muslims who live in these European countries go to Syria and fight for ISIS, but then I'm not sure why they maybe changed their mind or something and decide to move back to the European country. How do you think those governments should handle those people? Should they hail them as terrorists, or should they give them some kind of like psychological advice or some kind of help?
They should be extremely careful when taking them back. Anyone who goes to Syria or Iraq to fight in their so-called jihad, and then they go back to their lands, the government should be extremely careful. They could have a change of heart, and they could be coming back for acts of terrorism like what happened in France. What some of the Muslim government do when they capture people who are affiliated with Al-Qaeda or ISIS, they would not let them free back in the land, but they would hold them in an area, and they would bring religious leaders and spiritual leaders to talk to them and to try to change their opinion and the way that they have been thinking. And it worked. They do it in Muslim land and it works. They talk to them and they bring spiritual leaders and clarify to them that this is not part of Islam. And a lot of times people come back from them is because they think once they go, before they go there, they think that the Islamic State is a great Islamic State and they are fighting for the sake of Allah and that God will give them victory and so on and so on. And then they go there and they find something completely different, right? And then there is the story of the guy who was chosen by Allah. This is a famous story that happened last year. Two groups of people were talking about going to jihad. Two Muslims were talking about going to jihad. So they decided to go to Turkey, and then from Turkey they went to Syria to fight for ISIS. And then he stayed in this training camp for about 14 days. And then a man came to him and told him, "You have been chosen by God." He said, "To do what?" He said, "To do suicide bombing." He said, "How long have you been here?" He said, 14 years. He said, "I've been here for 14 days, and you've been here for 14 years. You should be chosen, not me." So he said, okay, just wait here. I will talk to the leaders. And it's known that if you refuse to do a suicide bomb, that they will kill you. So he ran away. And he went back to Turkey. And they didn't let him in because he didn't have a passport. So he told them his story. And then after they let him in and they felt that he was safe, it was safe for him to come in, he told the people his story. So all of these people, actually, when they blow themselves up, it's usually kids who are doing it. As for the leaders, if it's something that will actually take them to heaven and paradise, they should be the first one who are doing it, but they know it doesn't take them to paradise. And they would go to children, and they would brainwash them to do these evil acts. And Allah knows best.
Some people say that Muslims have been killing each other forever, that the Shiite and Sunni conflict is just something that's been going on forever, and this is a continuation of it. And your opinion on that, and then maybe the conflict between Iran and Saudi Arabia. If you would comment on both of those things.
Okay. As for the Muslims killing each other since the beginning, the Sunnah and the Shia, actually the Sunnah and the Shia have been living together for a long, long time. Sometimes it would be extremist groups who would try to fight each other and make it a battle between Sunnah and Shia, like what they are doing today. Like the battle in Syria was actually between Syrians versus the dictator Bashar al-Assad. But now it turned into Shia versus Sunnah. And it's actually not Shia versus Sunnah. It's extreme Sunnah versus extreme Shia. You look at Iraq. Iraq is a population of Sunnah and Shia. And they've been living together for a long, long time. And a Sunni would marry from the Shia, and a Shia would marry from the Sunnah, from the Sunni. And there is absolutely no trouble. But until war happens, and extremist groups from both sides, from the Shia and from the Sunni, take over, then the problems would happen. As for Saudi Arabia and Iran, the conflict between them is more of a political conflict. And this conflict was there for a long time, and it will continue to happen. And what happened basically is that the United States took the side of Saudi Arabia, and Russia took the side of Iran. So this is kind of like a political war that is happening right now. But it's not a war with guns, usually just politics, and then it dies down. And the lady had a question.
Thank you. I'm interested in knowing your background. I'm interested in knowing the mosques in the area. I understand Cedar Rapids has the first mosque in the United States. So obviously there's a long history. I'm familiar with where the mosque is in Iowa City. I understand there are more. So can you expand on your background and the history of the mosques here in this area?
Thank you. Well, my name is Mulhim Bilal. And my lovely mother is sitting in the second row. There she is. I was born in Egypt. I'm a Sudanese citizen, but I was born in Egypt, in Cairo, Egypt, and I lived there for about 10 years. There I went to an Islamic school, and it's a Quranic school in Egypt. At the age of 10, I came to the United States, and I've been here ever since. The mosque that we have right now in Iowa City is only one mosque. So we have only one community. And there are people from different parts of the world who come and pray. The majority are people who are from Sudan. And there are Egyptians and Arabs and Asians and Europeans and Americans. So all different groups of people would come and pray in this one mosque. And we don't differentiate between anyone. Why? Because the ceremony of the Prophet Muhammad, he said, anything ignorant today is under my feet. Today there is absolutely no difference between white and black. And there is no difference between red and yellow. All men are equal in the eyes of God. And the only difference between people is when it comes to purity of the heart. And that is known by no one other than God. So no one has the right to say, I am better than this person, or our country is better than that country. Everyone is equal. Everyone is the son of Adam. So we all come to this mosque, and there's only one mosque. The first mosque to be registered in the United States is the Mother Mosque, and that is located in Cedar Rapids. And the imam of that mosque, his name is Imam Ahmed. He's a very good man. And also there is about another mosque in Cedar Rapids, and that is in First Avenue, Cedar Rapids. And that is about the only mosques that are in Cedar Rapids and the Iowa City area. So it's just one community, just one group. Everyone prays together, and we're all just normal people like all of us. And by the way, the sound that everyone just heard now from people's phone, that is the call to prayer. That is the call to prayer. So we have 5 different prayers a day, right? And now is one of the times to make that prayer. I believe they will make it in a half an hour. In half an hour, we'll start praying. Yeah. And very good questions, by the way. Okay.
How's it going?
Great.
Can we get a round of applause for freedom of speech in this country? All right, well, our speaker said today that I believe Allah, the wonderful one, despises unjust killings. Is that correct?
That's correct.
So I just have a question about what does just mean? Well, I have an anecdote from my last night, actually. I went to a party. And it was a rough night for me, actually. I smoked a cigarette, I had a beer, and one of my friends started cooking up some bacon. And I had a few pieces. And while it was so good, I decided to renounce my Muslim faith. And I was just wondering, do you think it's just for me to be executed for that?
You have the freedom of choosing whatever faith you want in Islam. If someone wants to be a Muslim, and if someone wants to be a Christian, or any faith, or if someone wants to be an atheist, then they have the freedom of doing so. Allah says in the Quran, there is no compulsion in religion. And the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, said to the people, do not force anyone in accepting Islam. We are absolutely, as Muslims, not allowed in any situation to force anyone to accept Islam. And if you want to renounce Islam, and by the way, I have never seen you in the masjid, but I will take your word that you are a Muslim. If you want to renounce Islam, then in this country, you can do whatever you want. And you are free to practice whatever faith you want. That is freedom of religion, and that is freedom of speech. So we don't hate you if you renounce Islam. We still love you. And I would actually call you, if you're a Muslim, I say to you, come back to the faith. Come and eat breakfast with us in Ramadan. And if you don't want to do so, come and visit us. We can drink tea together and we can talk. But we have absolutely no hate for you, and we have absolutely no hate for anyone. The brother had a question.
Has there been a noticeable or recordable rise in extremism that coincides with the explosion of the internet and social media?
Yes, the extremists, they would use YouTube and the media and Facebook and Twitter to spread their message, especially Twitter. So if some of you go to Twitter and go to these extremist people, they will spread their message in this. So I believe what should be done is that there should be control of it. I mean, yes, we believe in freedom of speech, but at the same time, we don't believe in terrorism, and we don't believe in spreading terrorism. So my personal belief, and this is just an opinion, so anyone else can have a different opinion, is that the people who are controlling this website should look for any of these actions and report them, because they are dangerous and they lead to dangerous things. And they should block them and block anyone from seeing them. Because part of the way that the extremists and the terrorists spread their agenda is through social media. So fighting these extremists is not only by going to war against them, but you also have to fight them by lectures like this. And you have to fight against them in the media. And you have to fight against them in whatever area that they are in. And us as Muslims, we have a bigger responsibility than non-Muslims. Because these people are actually doing it in our faith. So we have a bigger responsibility of going out and calling them out of the people that they are. So I hope this answers your question. And I don't know if the social media is actually trying to fight it back or not. I have no knowledge of that. Brother.
Follow up with that question. What do you, as a leader, what do the other leaders do on a national for the United States and on an international level to get the word out that this is not how you live or want to live, and that these people are not representing you? So if you, as you said, the media is ignoring this or they're not reporting it, what do you do to get their attention, to get the word out?
Maybe what do we all do, perhaps? What do we all do, perhaps, to get that word out?
I think in the Muslim community generally, we are not doing enough to fight against it. And this is being honest. The Muslim communities are not doing enough to fight against it. Why? A lot of people say that we have nothing to do with these extremists. So why should we apologize for them? So this is the argument that they bring forward. We don't have to apologize for them because we have nothing to do with them. But we have the moral duty and the Islamic duty to warn the people of them and to fight against them, whether it's vocally or otherwise. So what we should do as a community of Muslims and non-Muslims is that we should spread the word and that we should have more talks like this and spread the websites that fight against them and let the people know. And we work with the FBI, and you have different groups of Muslim Islamic groups in the United States that work with the government of fighting these extremists. And actually, the reason why the United States have been more successful to fight these extremists than any other countries is because the government of the United States actually works with the mosques. And that is why the United States have been more successful. That's why you would not see another attack similar to 9/11. But in other countries, for example, in Europe, they give them more freedom because lots of the extremists actually come from Europe. So they give them more freedom to do so. I believe Sister Shams, she had a...
Thank you very much. To answer those last two questions, what do we as Muslims do? Two things. First thing, Imam Mulham was kind enough to address the role of Muslims in America. But we are a minority. We are what, 1% of the population of the US? We have a media that's owned by 5 corporations, okay? The word is out there. We write, we talk, we join interfaith dialogue, which is, I think, is a very important tool to fight all extremism, not just those that are done by those who claim to be Muslims, okay? So this is a joint effort. I do not think it is only the Muslim community that has to speak out, which we do. The question is, does our wonderful media actually share that? Some do, the majority don't. Then you have political leaders that are hunting in murky water. Just hear the GOP and the nonsense they are talking about. These are very difficult times in our country, and to stay united, we must speak as a country, as one community. Muslims, Jews, Christians, atheists, agnostics, everyone. If you hear something wrong after, you know, said against a fellow human being, whether Muslim, Jews, or Christian, speak up. Don't just sit there and listen to it or join the hoopla that the likes of Trump and others are saying. This is our role, not only as Muslims, but as Americans. This is the United States of America, and to keep it united, speak up.
Thank you, Sister Shams. Sister Shams, by the way, she's part of our communities, and she's one of the community leaders in our mosque. So thank you. He had a question.
I think we have one time for one more question.
Okay, no problem.
I'm sorry, I don't mean to monopolize this, but just as a matter of mechanics, most of the major Western religions are organized in a hierarchical type fashion with some sort of spiritual head on earth and then various subdivisions and such coming on down, synods and such. Is Islam organized in that same way? Or how is Islam organized worldwide?
Okay. Good question. In Islam, everyone is the same. No one is different. Whether it's someone who's the grand mufti, the spiritual leader, or not, they are all the same. And they all have to abide by the same exact law. And we are not allowed in Islam to say that the imam of the mosque is better than the community, or that the spiritual leader of one country is better than the people of that country. So in Islam, we believe everyone is the same. The only difference between people in Islam is the knowledge that they have, right? That will make them different, but it will not make them better than each other. Right, so I am not better than anyone, and no one is better than me. When it turns in terms of piety and goodness of the heart, that is known by no one other than God. So we don't have that system. Okay, you have the top person, then the other person, and so on. Everyone exactly the same. What's in your heart is known by God, and that's it, and no one else. So, okay, the last one.
Good afternoon. I have a question, I have a comment, and then a question, and that can be addressed by the imam or anyone. First, when you talk about extremism comes in all forms. Since 2000, according to FBI data, extremism has been on the rise in the United States. Now, that extremism comes from radical groups like militias, the Klan. For example, let's take the Klan. The Klan's membership has been up from 45,000, a handful of 45,000, post or pre 9/11, to about over 100,000. I think since 2013, their numbers have declined. There was even a group here in a small town, drawn a blank, but Oxford. There was even a chapter in Oxford. Okay, this sort of highlights what Shams is talking, what Sister Shams talks about. The media perception gives us the idea that we are under threat from terrorism, and then it is up to the Muslims to speak out. But in fact, we have speaking out, and I applaud the brothers and sisters in the community that have come out today, because Muslims have been speaking out against terrorism. Muslims have been fighting against terrorism. Look at what happened in Jordan with the pilot and the response from the Jordanian government, and what King Faisal, his response to what ISIL or Daesh has said, and their activities. So there's a lot of misconception, and that is perpetuated by the media, that we don't speak out. Every scholar, every organization, CARE, ISNA, Islamic Society of North America, organizations in Europe. There was a girl who raised over $35,000 this year, who, in response to the church burnings, church shooting, the shooting that happened down south. And this Muslim girl raised $35,000, but how many of us know about it? Where's CNN? Where's Fox? So the media is one issue, the perception of danger, that we are under threat from every Muslim, Muslim terrorists, when in fact, you look at the data, we're more likely to die from in the United States by getting shot by a police officer. And that is not something that I made. That is actually a fact. An American is more likely to die from being shot by a police officer, not by being killed by a terrorist. More Americans have died, and I don't mean to go on, but more Americans have died in gun violence than killed by terrorists. And you can do that research for yourself. My question is, knowing these facts, which you can research yourself, why do Muslims feel obligated to apologize? Why should we feel that it is our duty to denounce terrorism? And that is the irony in the whole thing, is that we have to apologize. We have to explain and educate, which we should. We should. But does an American, does a Christian or a white person apologize for Timothy McVeigh? Do you feel that you have to apologize for what Donald Trump says when he spreads hate every day? Or what? Yeah, you might. You might want to. But we say he's an idiot. But, you know, when someone like Timothy McVeigh or the young man who did the church shooting or Jared Lautner, and the names go on. When they kill in the name of their faith or ideology, the average American doesn't feel the need to apologize for what they did. The religion is not under attack. And that is the problem. That is the problem. That is the paradox in this whole thing. And again, question is, why do we have to apologize? When, in fact, isn't that not a double standard for other faiths, for other groups?
Thank you for your comment. In terms of why do Muslims have to apologize and non-Muslims don't have to apologize, it is a double standard. It is, and everyone knows that. It is something that is obvious. But just because other people don't apologize and don't condemn the actions that are done by some extremist groups that are affiliated to those people, to Christianity or to any other groups, right? It doesn't mean that us as Muslims, we don't have to condemn them. We have to condemn them more than the other groups have to condemn their groups. Why? If we are living in a Muslim country, then no one is gonna condemn the actions and say we're against this and so on, because everyone knows it. But here we are living in a country, as the sister has mentioned, that is 1% Muslim. And the people are ignorant about Islam. They're not ignorant about Christianity. They're not ignorant about other faiths, but they are ignorant, they don't know much about Islam. So it's easy for them to take any information, and soon as they see, okay, terrorists in the media, Islamic terrorism, okay, Islam is a religion of terrorism. So just because we're here in a non-Muslim country, then it's for us, we have, as Muslims, we have even more of an obligation to condemn them, more than the Muslims who live in Muslim countries. Because those who live in Muslim countries, they know that this is not part of Islam. But the sad reality is that the media puts it out as if these terrorists are part of Islam, so that's why we have to go out and we have to condemn it even more. And we end it at this because I'm told that I cannot take any more questions. So thank you so much, and thank you for listening. And on behalf of the Iowa City Mosque and the Muslim community, we thank all of you. We thank all of you, and we hope that we have more events like this, similar to this. And we appreciate all of you coming and learning the truth about Islam and that Islam is against terrorism. Thank you very much. I hope all of you have a good day.